Adam Savage from Tested here, and you know how much I love spacesuits. I am standing next to the spacesuit, the OG. This is what my brain thinks of when I think of spacesuit. This is, of course, Neil Armstrong's iconic suit. He went to the moon and back in. Now, this isn't the actual suit. Spoiler alert, this is a magnificent fiberglass and resin replica made from high-res scanned data from Neil Armstrong's original suit. It's part of a program called Apollo at the Park, in which 15 of these are being constructed right now to be displayed in ballparks around the country as part of the 50th anniversary celebration of the moon landing, so that every American can come and see Neil Armstrong's suit in as much glorious detail as they want. The scan has been done to the exact specs of the original suit as it will be displayed this summer at the Smithsonian. And we're gonna learn a little bit about how something like this comes together. Now, I said that Neil Armstrong's suit was built from scans. Those scans were turned into a digital drawing, which then was output, and this is the output. This is actually 3D printed. I'm used to 3D printing, but like on scales like this, not this. Lisa, how does something like this come into being?
Well, this was a fun project, and so whenever we start a new project, certainly with a client like the Smithsonian, we say to them, first question, where do you want to be at the end of the day? And then we work backwards from there to come up with a solution. That's typically a sweet spot between technology and craftsmanship. So we knew we needed to get the ultimate out of the 3D scan in a 3D print. Yeah. So what we chose was a machine called a voxel jet. It's relatively new. The spacesuit itself was built in 16 sections, so it was split pretty much right down the side, and then the front to back were the 16 different sections.
So eight on each side, perhaps, just to get the right amount of volume for a print?
And then also, anytime you're running a print in general, you want to kind of use up as much as the build envelope as possible, so you want to nest those parts in there.
Oh!
And so that you're building them all at the same time and hopefully not making, you know, not wasting material. And what's unique about the voxel jet, although it is it's an acrylic powder, so some 3D printers produce resin, and some have a filament, which is basically a resin that's then heated and melted. But in the case of the voxel jet, it's a powder that's fused by a laser. And when you look at the machine, it's an entire bed of powder, which looks and acts a lot like plaster.
Yeah.
So it's supporting the whole thing as
it
builds.
Right. It provides a lot of topological fidelity with overhangs and things like that that are really difficult for filament printers to take care of.
Well, yes, it does. And also, it gives it structural integrity. So we have to somehow keep the part from collapsing onto itself while it's being built. So the build layers themselves were 150 microns, whereas a typical build for some of the high resolution printers for small things might be 15 microns.
Yeah.
So, but it's still very, very, very large. I mean, that's a very large print. And then we, a full build is 3,333 layers.
It's really 3,333?
3,333.
That's neat.
And also the resolution, the fidelity of the print itself is about 650 microns.
Wow.
So at that level, we're able to pick up stitching. We're able to pick up, we were able to pick up the actual lettering that, you know, that was there from the patch. You know, here it's been primed there's a release agent on here to facilitate the casting. But we got everything in here. I mean, it's incredible.
I'm standing next to it and it feels like I'm looking at a piece of cloth until I touch it, and then it's absolutely rigid.
Yeah.
But it's incredible how much detail is, like you said, individual stitches are all really visible.
Yeah, I mean, and the other thing to note is that the data itself, the finished scan data, was 5.3 gigabytes of information.
Just for the suit.
Just for the suit.
Wow.
And it was made from a combination of scanning methods, which is a Brakeman structured light scanner. Those are aerospace quality machines. They're not laser. And then it was some of the details of the ports and things were done with a ferro touch probe.
And so there was multiple types of scans to put all the data together. Amazing. And so this is the monolithic first 3D print, fully assembled, finished, sanded, primed. And after this, it was cast, is that right?
After this, it was cast. And then when we assembled it, there are actual grooves in each piece that were engineered into the individual parts so we could have complete 100% assurance when we were putting it together.
Oh, so you built keys right into the files so that the 3D prints could be assembled.
Exactly.
Nice.
And then because it was going on to casting, we also wanted to give it even some additional structural integrity. Mm-hmm. So there was a support structure, kind of a honeycomb support structure that was also built on the inside of it that was engineered prior to the build even happening.
So just when to make the build sure that the final assembly was stable.
Yeah. So yeah. When the build was happening, it was building the exterior of the suit, it was building those grooves, and it was also building that honeycomb support structure.
Fascinating.
Yeah, very, very cool project.
This is roto-molding. I know it looks crazy, but it is in fact the most efficient way to get a uniform coating of resin across the entire inside of the mold. I admit I have never seen a roto-molder this large, and these guys built this beautiful machine here on site. Sometimes when you want to innovate, there's no one that makes what you want. You got to make it yourself. And this is fresh out of the mold, Jazz. I'm amazed that you guys cast this monolithically as one entire giant piece. Can you walk me through that process?
Yeah, when this came up as to be molded, our whole idea was to do as much as we can in one casting and not having to go back and join stuff together, because resin is not a good medium where you want to glue them or join them.
Right, you have a lot of, you seam finishing, all that's going to kill you in terms of time.
Plus, you know, there was so much texture here of the fabric, we wanted to keep that intact.
Course,
so when you repair, you sand, you take it off.
So the process of casting it as one piece was also to make sure it was as accurate as possible.
Yes, there Amazing. You go. Yeah, so all these ports, they are all one piece. So all we're doing is a little bit of the mold lines that are there, which are very minimal, that we were taken off.
So, now, you made a large fiberglass and silicone mold, I assume.
Yes.
And then how do you cast the resin? You pour it in?
Well, yeah, we pour it in, and there's a few processes that we go through.
Okay.
And it's built layer by layer.
And it's roto-molded.
It's roto-molded.
That is amazing. Yeah, you have a roto-molding machine big enough for something this big?
Oh, we can do twice as big, yes.
Wow. Yeah. And then you also had to choose a resin that was dimensionally stable.
Yes, that was a little bit of R&D on our end. Based
right.
on how much detail we're capturing, we kind of blend our casting material.
Okay.
So here there was a lot of detail, so we had to blend it thinner. So we capture it more and more at every turn.
Right.
So yeah.
Well, I mean, I look at things like these thin walls and these cut-ins.
Oh, yeah,
I mean, for
a big silicone
mold, as they're peeling it off, that's got to be really careful work to make sure you don't break the silicone or the resin.
Yes. And there takes three guys.
Really?
To actually take this piece out in one piece.
So just getting it out of the mold is in and of itself a multi-hour procedure.
Yes, definitely.
Such incredible craftsmanship.
Yes.
Okay, so it'll spend a few hours in here getting it sanding and getting finished, and then it moves on to priming and painting?
Priming.
You never know what you're going to discover when you go onto site to do a story. And here we are covering the Apollo suits casting. And it turns out that Jazz's company, Wesco, makes one of my personal favorite products. They make this stuff, Magic Sculpt, which is sort of like a two-part epoxy putty. Well, it is not sort of, it is exactly that. Kind of like plumber's epoxy, only much, much better because it's been formulated specifically for sculptors and artists. How do I know? Because I've been using this stuff for over 30 years. Yeah, you never know what you're gonna find. I'm so glad I have met the source of one of my favorite projects. Okay, my favorite part, the painting. Now, Paula and Chris, after Jazz is finished putting the final coat of white on the castings, you guys get it and you take it the final 10 yards. Can you walk me through the process of the finishing that you guys do on this?
Yeah, we did a lot of R&D to begin with. We kind of airbrush it? Are we going to hand paint it? What paints are we going to use? What colors are we going to use?
Making sure the textures look right. And these are all anodized aluminum. These are all hard colors to get right.
Yes, and they take many coats. And some of them are enamel and some of them are acrylic.
Well, one of the things, what we start with is putting green tape on. Tape off all around these ports.
Okay, so masking to get the detail paint.
Yeah, mask it because we don't want paint going on other things. Mm-hmm. And then we do multiple layers. Like, for example, this red. Mm-hmm. Two coats of a basic red and then a pearl red.
Yeah.
And then the gold is actually an enamel.
Mm-hmm.
And then this, of course, has to be painted red on the inside. And silver here, four coats on here. It just takes a lot of attention to detail to get that right because we want it to look authentic.
Now, one of the hardest things to replicate, in my opinion, is the look of the chromel, the metal mesh that makes up the gloves. And you guys got this amazing texture. Did you make a color chart of a whole bunch of different attacks on getting that metallic look?
Tried different painting, and we settled on a pewter that just captured the look. And we also did a template so that we could do a stitching.
Is that drawn on?
Yeah, that is drawn on.
Wow, that's brilliant.
Yeah.
A little custom template for both of those straps.
It's too hard to do that, a template. So I made up a template, so that's the way we do that.
Yeah, we even do the threading on here with a little pen that is beige.
Yeah.
So that threading sticks out a little bit.
That is amazing. And then, of course, there's the decals. These are applied up on top. Is that correct?
Yeah. This was a beta cloth is what these were made out of originally.
Yeah.
And I was able to find a beta cloth for this one, but had to do some photoshopping to get these other decals. And this, you don't see it here, but there is a cheat sheet here. We'll have to show
right. Yes, the wrist checklist.
Yes, that is also...
And the way these were done, we ended up, it was a process trying to figure out how best to do it. But the way we ended up doing it was with a t-shirt maker.
Oh, okay.
And using epoxy to apply them.
I see. So then it conforms to the...
To those shapes.
Right,
that was the hardest part of getting that. We tried other adhesives, but ended up using epoxy. And
You also have to make all of this archival, right? It's got to be ultraviolet stable and all of that. That's another whole layer of
requirement. And finished with an auto spray so that it can be weathered outdoors.
Right. And then there's the moon dust. You have to do this very subtle weathering pass, right?
Yeah, I started doing it with an airbrush, and then we decided he could do it back there even better. So
with sprayer.
Hand applique.
We just sprayed it and more at the feet and just kind of... Very artistically done.
It really comes through. It must be, for me, I find painting to be my favorite part. To me, you have the most fun job because the whole thing sort of comes to life under your hands, doesn't it?
You feel really good
really
about
it. Stands out.
So there you have it, a brief insight and small visit into the large number of companies, ingenuity, and craftspeople it takes to execute a project of this historical importance and this level of complexity. This is part of a program, again, put on by the Smithsonian called Apollo at the Park. These beautiful suits will be displayed at ballparks all across the country leading up to the reveal of Neil Armstrong's original moon suit back at the Smithsonian on July 16th, the 50th anniversary of the launch date for Apollo 11. See you on the moon.